Welcome back. You're tuned into the My Cool Inventions Network. I love this segment. It's called Selling Secrets. That's right. We get all kinds of questions from inventors all around the world here. We've been doing this for 6 years. We got tens of thousands of inventors who are engaged with the program, hundreds of thousands of you guys watching. Maybe you're an entrepreneur. Maybe you're a businessman. Maybe you run a shop down the corner. Maybe you're an inventor. We always like to answer your questions. And if you have any questions, just type them right in there, especially if you're watching on the Facebook live stream. You can just type it right in there on the Facebook live stream, the questions. You can email us at AKOS, A-K-O-S, that's my name, at mycoolinventions.com. We get questions all along. One of the questions that came in, though, was, it's actually a very important question. It said, and the question was, how do you protect your product or your patent if it's made outside of the United States? So what's the patent protection law? So let's say you're like Tim Roberts, our Pawn John's chair guy, and he patents his product here in America. So he goes to the USPTO, United States Patent and Trademark Office, USPTO.gov. Throw that up there, Tony, for everybody. USPTO.gov, that website, and he starts the patent process, right? So let's say he's granted a patent. We'll talk about patents in a sec. Oh, thanks, Al. On their USPTO. Fantastic screen. So you go there and you start your patent, trademark, and all whatever you're doing, all your intellectual property patent protection thing, right? So you start that process. Maybe you hire a lawyer, maybe you hire a consultant, or maybe you just do it yourself. Many of my inventors have done it themselves. You go there and you secure yourself some protection here in the United States, all right? There's a couple of pictures, there's the website right there, USPTO.gov, and you see some drawings. Now, this will take a little bit of effort on your part. You'll have to fill out some forms. You have to do some drawings. You can get this information at the library if you like, or go Google this thing online. Actually, how to do your own patent. People have done it themselves. I mean, I'm a busy man, so I do hire someone to do mine. And a provisional patent, which is the patent pending, which we'll talk about maybe another program or now, is that first step. It's about $1,500. Or if you do it yourself, you can do it for whatever your time and effort and labor is. So you get yourself your patent pending. Now, the question was, let's say you go get this thing made in China. Let's say you go make this thing made in Europe. Is there protection over there if you have a U.S. patent? There isn't. No. There are not. You're not protected in those countries if you have a U.S. patent. You must file a patent in the other countries to get patent protection also. I know I just disappointed a lot of you, but that's true. But here's how it works, okay? You file in the U.S., you have to file separately in Canada. It's a different country, different patent registry. So you have to go file your patents in these registry offices, all right? Now, once you do your U.S. patent, though, there is some protection time allotted for you. You have a year to go do something. So the other countries will recognize the U.S. patent for a year and not allow anybody else to sort of jump on your patent. But if you leave it too long, somebody else can jump on your patent. I got a personal story myself. I have a trademark called Stains Are Out. Stains Are Out. I've got a patent protected almost everywhere in the world, and I overlooked Korea. Right? And what, wouldn't you know, somebody, some crook, some opportunist went and filed my trademark. And if I had a patent, I'm sure they filed my laundry sheets patent over there. And I didn't pay attention to Korea and I lost that market. I wasn't able to protect my products in that market. So to answer your question about patents, if you've patented here in Canada or here in the United States on North America, it doesn't protect you in other countries permanently. However, they will give you one year leeway. So you have a year to go do your filing process before you're kind of in trouble. So you have a little bit of time to file the patent in other countries, but not too much time to file the patent in other countries. While we're on the topic of patents, let me give you a little process here in the States, because the guy, like we just talked to our buddy there, Tim Roberts, and we're talking about intellectual property. Al's got one of the forms there. If you look at the video there, one of the forms that you fill out for the patent process. So you go to the USPTO.gov. I just type in, how do I file a patent? They'll give you all kinds of information right there and then. It'll give you forms you got to fill out, and you fill it out, right? So when you fill out all your forms, you send it over to them, right? They have like a patent review process, and they will review that. Is it patentable? Is there previous patents that cover the same topic? Now, they call that artwork. And I remember when I first started this whole thing in my career, I didn't know what artwork meant when it I've referred to patents. What it is, file the art. When they're talking about art, they're talking about those, you know, those line drawings, and they use that art to compare it to different art. So if you have got a chair, for example, like Tim Roberts, he would file a very detailed picture and with a little number scale that identified each part or each component and exactly what it did, and that artwork gets filed. So they'll take that artwork and they'll compare it to other artwork, and they'll say, hey, is that similar? Is that patentable? Is it just copying somebody else's patent? Is it too close to somebody else's patent? And we'll talk about what's too close in a second too. So what they'll do is they say, okay, all right, okay, Tim, that chair's a little bit different. We've not seen that before. We think it's ready for the next step. And then what they'll do is they'll grant you what they call a provisional patent. We call that loosely patent pending. Have you ever heard that term on the radio or TV? It says patent pending. Well, that means there's a person out there who's filed a patent and it's pending. It's not quite patented yet, but it's a good enough filing that the patent office rendered protection for a year. So in that patent pending stage, you can start doing stuff, assuming that you are going to go through with the final patent. Let me tell you why that's so important. Because patents can be very expensive, depending on what you're doing. It can be very, very, very expensive. Now, you heard Tim Roberts say something, like, I didn't want to bring it up in the interview there, but one of our inventors said he wrote all the drawings and he mailed it to himself. So he thinks that by mailing it to himself, and he doesn't open the envelope, he's got a post office seal there, it's unopened envelope. He thought that if he tried to prove that his idea was first, right? He had the idea first, then if somebody else came along and patented it, he would have the argument, hey, my idea first. Hate to disappoint you, Tim. Hogwash. Doesn't hold any, that paper is not worth the paper it was printed on. It wasn't worth the stamp you put on the envelope, right? And I'll tell you why. Because in this country, in the United States of America, it's not first to come up with the idea, it's first to file the patent. So if you have come up with the idea and somebody comes along later and files the patent, you're up that creek with no paddle. And it's a good thing you have one of those pond johns, because you can sit by the side of the creek and you can watch the guy floating around with a paddle, right? So just because you've mailed yourself an envelope doesn't count. It's not valid. I mean, I don't think it has any merit whatsoever. The laws have changed. I don't even think that was a way to do it in the old days. I think to somebody's, I think it was more or less of a wives' tale. Maybe he had some proof first to use, but even an envelope with a picture on it isn't the first to use something. But if you want protection on your product, if you want protection of your idea, you must file it first. First to file is king, all right? Not first to come up with the idea. And there's the filing form right there. So everybody go to the USPTO.gov office website. You want to file that form. You want to get that certificate at the end of the game. That's a patent certificate. And what you want to do is you want to go to the USPTO, United States Patent and Trademark Office, USPTO, United States Patent and Trademark Office. You can start your search there. How do I file a patent? So you all understand? So I'm starting to talk like a guy from Alabama. Y'all understand? So what you do is you get the filing in and you get kind of temporary approval on it. They say, hey, okay, thumbs up. Okay, that's pretty good. That's called a provisional patent. But you have a year to execute. Okay, I'll tell you what that means. You have a year to execute, and then you want to get the final patent. Okay, so that's what you do. And in that year, you can start marketing, you can start selling, you can start trying to license the idea, because patents can be really expensive. That's why they give you that year to say, hey, maybe the patent's not viable. You don't want to go spend $250,000 on a patent that's worth nothing because you can't sell it. Here's a year. Go get it, Tiger. You know, go see if you can go sell these things, and then it'll cover you. Now, Steve Warple, our Glide Guys, Universal Furniture Glide Guys. Hey, make sure you get in touch with Bonnie. We were on the phone yesterday with the Inventor Showdown buyers. They want you on that first episode. So we got to get your forms filled out. We got to get those samples. Make sure you talk to Bonnie today, Steve. I know you're listening. And he just wrote there, Glide Guys for Universal Furniture Glide, very expensive to fight infringement. All right. That's a good point. All right. Here's the deal. Once you get your patent, people copy you. Then you got to go fight them. And let me tell you something. I have I mean, gosh, I need a whole segment on this. I can list people who what I call are patent trolls. I can list people who are completely immoral. They go out and completely copy the patents, and they go out and sell it. And some poor guy like Steve Vorpel or Noah Brader with the reversible umbrella is my primary example. He gets to go fight it. And let me tell you, it can cost a lot of money to fight. I'm going to talk about Noah Brader. There's a company out there that copied Noah Brader. And so right now, Noah Brader's lining up his guns to fight him because they copied his reversible umbrella. Now, Steve Vorpel with his furniture glide guys, looks like he's in an expensive fight to fight infringement. Maybe he is and isn't, but he made the point it's very expensive to fight the infringement. So that's why sometimes it's good to, because here's how these nasty guys work. They figure, okay, there's Steve Vorpel and furniture guides. How much can they afford to fight him? We're going to go sell $100 million of his product. And when he fights us, we'll throw a couple hundred grand at him, whatever it takes, and make him shut him up. That's usually what happens. I'm going to tell you something. That usually what happens. Steve, just go to Bonnie@InVentures International. Steve just asked, how do I contact Bonnie? Bonnie@InVenturesInternational.com. Maybe, Tony, you can get Bonnie's phone number and throw it up there for Steve, too, if you don't mind. So what I want you to do, sometimes it costs a lot of money to fight that bad. And we're going to have another episode later on how to fight those infringers. But that's the answer to your question. Just because you patent the United States doesn't cover you in the rest of the countries. You got to go file those patents in those countries, too. Now, there's groupings of those countries. We'll have another show on that that makes it easy to file in groups of countries like the Pacific and the European Union. There's groupings together. So you don't have to file in every single country. You can file in these groups of countries. We'll talk about that another time. But just because you filed it in the United States doesn't protect you in the rest of the world. You have a year, a little breathing space, but it's not a long. A year goes by really fast. Hey, that's our segment on selling secrets on My Cool Inventions. If you have a question on how you want it answered, type it in there. Email it to us, acos@mycoolinventions.com. That's acos@mycoolinventions.com. Send your question. Maybe we'll talk about it here live on the radio, mycoolinventions.com.